Hello, my name is Devarian Baldwin, and today we're going to talk about the Great Migration, the meaning behind the movement. The Great Migration is one of the most epic yet profoundly misunderstood social movements in U.S. history. Between 1910 and 1970, over 6 million African Americans moved from the U.S. South to northern and western states, and in the process, they changed the world. Now, we have pretty much widely held consensus about what happened. But today, we want to use history to explore why. Why did the Great Migration happen? So first, what happened? And to discuss what happened, we have to introduce the notion of push and pull factors. So first, in the U.S. South, cotton was king. It was the dominant cash crop, the crop that was sold for profits. Everyone produced and harvested cotton, and it was king in the U.S. South. Now that makes for a very lucrative crop, but it also makes it very susceptible to environmental factors. So for example, when the boll weevil came from Mexico to the U.S. South and began to feast on cotton, this devastated the single crop economy of cotton. The result of this is that it pushed many African American farmers working in rural areas to U.S. southern cities. So that's one factor. That's one push factor when it came to the Great Migration. Now consider one of the major pull factors. During World War I, the major source of workers in U.S. northern factories came from European immigrants. But during World War I, that flow of immigrants was shut down because of immigration restrictions. And so it's been said that industrialists and their agents looked south for African-American workers to come north and fill that void. This is considered a major pull factor, that industry pulled black workers north. Now, when we consider these two major factors, the push of the boll weevil and the pull of World War I, we can look at the African-American migration as being consistent with the larger story of the American dream. That just like any other migrant group, the U.S. was a land of opportunity, and that industry was the savior, and American capitalism was their salvation. In this story, it makes it seem that human beings were simply a product or responded to larger social forces. But history offers a complication to that general story. We have seen in historical archives and records that there were African American workers who came north, worked on jobs, and then after a couple of days, they would leave those jobs and go off and do whatever they wanted. So this small anecdote in its accumulation suggests in certain kind of ways that African Americans were not just leaves, southern leaves blown north, that they were making decisions. And what would it mean to suggest that the opportunities that agents offered them to come north and work in factories, that was not their end goal, simply industrial opportunity. But maybe that factory work was a means to a larger end. This is really important. We consider that the African-American migrant story doesn't fit fully within the U.S. immigration story because the U.S. alone wasn't their salvation. It was also the home of their terror. And they wanted to go anywhere where terror didn't exist, that their larger end goal was a search for freedom, that when African Americans came north, it wasn't just simply a response to large social forces, but they were making a decision to get north as a way to achieve their desired freedom from the terror of the U.S. South. Now, when we discuss U.S. terror in the U.S. South, what do we mean by that? This helps us understand the why. So number one is the reality of Jim Crow segregation, that in all public accommodations, African Americans were considered or put in a position of being separate but equal, meaning in schoolhouses, in buses, in water fountains, in public parks, in swimming pools, in everything. They were not just separate but equal, but their resources were inferior. Number two was the reality of white capping. Even in the face of racial discrimination, some African Americans were able to accumulate enough wealth to acquire land and develop a modest level of prosperity. This made both poor and rich whites extremely jealous. And so they would begin to organize into bands of night terrorists, raiders. This could be night riders or even the later the Ku Klux Klan, to intimidate African Americans off their land or even seize their land. And this is called white capping. And then the final thing I want to discuss right now is just a simple threat of if African Americans stepped outside of certain social mores of how black people should act in an inferior or modest way. For example, if there could be a black person walking down a street and a white person coming the other way, and the black person had to walk, get off the sidewalk and walk into the street to get out of their way, or how black adults would have to call white children Miss and Mister. So these various forms of black humility would be reinforced by the threat of lynching. And the thing about this is that lynching was something that was seen by whites as a kind of a public amusement. That in the same way that you might go to the to a county fair or go to an amusement park, white Americans would lynch African Americans, as you can see in the picture below, and then take pictures. The reason why we have this picture is because it was a postcard that someone who attended a lynching sent to a friend or a family somewhere else to say, look what we did last night. So this is the kind of terror that we're talking about when we think about a major reason why African Americans would make the decision to leave everything they knew, to leave their home in the South and to head north. They weren't just simply leaving because of economic opportunity in the North. They were leaving because economic opportunity was a means to the larger end of freedom from terror. Now, how do we get to these stories? Because people weren't just forthcoming with saying, I want to leave the South to free myself from terror. Well, one of the ways we get at that is looking at cultural sources in history as windows into the muted or the more modest or the unspoken motivations that African Americans face in terrorist South. So, for example, looking at Jacob Lawrence's amazing Great Migration series, one of the most profound panels in that series states, as we see below, another cause was lynching. It was found that where there had been a lynching, the people who were reluctant to leave at first left immediately after this. And so we see here in this wonderful painting that the figure on the rock has no head, and the lynch rope on the tree has no head as well, suggesting, as others have argued, that this could be anybody lynched at any time for any reason. The uncertainty of it, the universality of lynching for black people is profoundly exhibited in this piece from Jacob Lawrence. Another window into the motivation, the unspoken motivation about why African Americans would leave the South, comes in the beautiful song by Billie Holiday called Strange Fruit. Take a listen.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar tree.
Wow. So just to go back to the lyrics for a minute, southern trees bear strange fruit. I mean, what a powerfully evocative imagery. The idea that the fruits of a prosperous South were lynched bodies, that the blood of black bodies is what fertilizes the green grass, the magnolia, the sweet magnolias, all these icons of Southern beauty, the rolling hills, the Southern breeze carries the scent of black burning flesh, black bodies swinging in the Southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. So in this somber and provocative song, we see a melding together of the Southern pastoral or romantic environment of the prosperous South. Is literally the product of the death of black bodies. So here we have a powerful reason about why African Americans would leave everything they knew and make the decision to leave the South. So taking these things in their total, we can understand that the Great Migration is not just a movement of bodies, but it's a social movement. A social movement where black people came together in a collective force and decided to say no more. Farewell, we're good and gone. We're quitting the South is a phrase you would often hear when people left. That people came together in the cover of night amongst their families through migration chains, sending letters to friends and family already in the North, making plans to make a decision to quit and leave the South, to say no more to Southern terror, and let's go to the North, where we don't know what's going to be there, but it must be better than what we are facing right here. And so the lesson we learn from this is that social forces are huge. They do shape who we are, but people's decisions are what make history. Even in the face of insurmountable odds, like the terror of Jim Crow, in moments of profound crisis, when people come together, anything is possible. Thank you.